Welcome to Blackwell's Pizza, best-selling author of The Silk Roads. Congratulations on your new book, The New Silk Roads. We tend to think here in the West that the world revolves around us. So thank you for surprising us all with your ability to, I would say, put things in the right perspective. And thank you for coming this evening. It's an absolute pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much for asking me.
First of all, we love to talk about books here in Blackwell's. So may I start by asking you which books you think have influenced you the most?
Gosh, well, I've been a reader since I was very small. I read quickly and I read everything. I sort of don't understand sometimes at schools we teach geography or history or science, like they're different subjects. I'm a terrible guest at people's houses. The first thing I do is I go to their bookshelves and I see what they have there. And I have a few people who I know who I don't trust because they don't seem to have any books in their house. So I read lots and everything, and each book does something different for me. So I don't have a sort of hierarchy of which books do I think of most, but I fell in love really as a historian with Russian literature when I was about 15 or 16 years old.
Is there anything interesting that you're reading at the moment or perhaps would like to recommend us, and is it in Chinese?
No, not in Chinese. I suppose what I've been reading today, I've been reading the new report by the Kazakh army about their view about what Russia is doing at the moment. We're speaking today, there's a lot of activity between Russia and the invasion of Ukraine and tension in the Black Sea. So I'm reading, trying to see what's happening. Decision makers both in Moscow and in Kiev, where martial law has been declared this week in some parts of the country, but also to see what the reactions are in Tehran and in cities like Istanbul or Ankara in Turkey and across the Middle East. So I try to sort of gather up lots of materials. At the moment, I'm reading lots of what's going on in real time rather than
literature.
Books in literature. Yeah. But it's nearly Christmas time. And the good thing about Christmas time is I try to stop working. I light the fire. And if there's nothing really good on TV, which there never seems to be anything good on TV, I curl up with a book. So I've got a big pile to get through over Christmas and the New Year.
The new Silk Roads, all the roads used to lead to Rome, now they lead to Beijing. This quote is quite literal when we think about China's investment over the last 5 years, such as their OBOR policy. Can you explain a bit more about President Xi's ideas?
So in 2013, the President of China gave a speech in Central Asia about how the countries of the Silk Road, so more or less the region between the Pacific Ocean and the Mediterranean, have been connected to each other over the last few thousand years and seen lots of exchanges, and the exchanges of goods, of languages, of ideas, and so on. And he gave a vision of how these worlds could be connected together more in a stronger way. And one way to do that is to build infrastructure, building roads and energy plants and power stations and so on. And China has committed, well, we argue a little bit about the exact numbers, but many hundreds of billions of dollars into these kinds of schemes in many neighbouring countries and also not so neighbouring countries. But in some cases, when you invest heavily, it requires a repayment of debt. And we're all watching very carefully to see whether states are able to pay back, whether all these projects are necessarily good ones. But China is very clearly on the move at the moment in trying to play a global leadership role. And some of that is because of what's going on in the United States, but some of that is also about how China is understanding its own role in the present and what it thinks its role will be in the future, so what it needs and how it can influence regional and global affairs.
Yeah, Sigmar Gabriel said last year that China currently seems to be the only country, though, in the world with any sort of generally global geostrategic concept. Do you agree with him? Are Russia or the States only old game players? And is it the Western world asleep and unaware of what is brewing in the East?
Well, I think a lot of other states have bold plans for the future. India has multiple plans of new corridors that it's building and investing in with its neighbours. Iran, Saudi Arabia, Kazakhstan, Russia all have detailed and ambitious plans. Whether all of these will become real is one question. But I think what's interesting about them is that they are very different to how we're thinking about the present and the future in Europe, where our questions here about what does Europe mean, what is our future, do we have anything in common with each other after all, how do we try to cooperate with 28 European Union states, and how do we try and find a way of dealing with problems that are linked to all of us, like migration, eventually with climate change. And I think here in Europe we are not very well enabled to look into the future. And to an extent our challenge, I think, is that these countries along the Belt and Roads, along the Silk Roads of the present day, have about 5 billion people. That's about 65% of the world's population, and they are not just rising the populations, but they are becoming much, much wealthier. And that means that the things that they, that the people in these countries eat, how they travel, how they move around, what they're interested in, starts to shape our world as well as their own.
You were just mentioning China's investment. A lot of people are actually wondering what China's aims are, why all these investments around the world, not only building facilities, but also willing to turn a blind eye to excessive debt levels or government corruption on the country's recipient of the aid. Are we facing some kind of modern colonialism through this investment in maybe Africa and like other places?
I think everybody's waiting, is watching with and holding their breath. I think that there have been two or three high-profile cases where the debt has gone wrong, and China then has chosen to behave by taking one case in Sri Lanka, control of a port for 99 years on a lease as a payment, and that doesn't send a particularly encouraging message. On the other hand, 85% of the projects seem to be going according to plan. And the problem, I think, is not about investing in other countries or building infrastructure. It's first, is that the most appropriate infrastructure? And is there any point building a six-lane highway across the centre of Turkmenistan where there are hardly any cars? But on the other hand, if you're going to build power stations that can give power to cities like Karachi or Lahore with populations of 12, 15, 20 million people, that costs money. And banks and Western investors don't really want to get involved in countries they think are unstable. So China can play a role in all of this. But I think that, that at the moment there's a lot of discussion inside China as well about what the Belt and Road is, about what kind of China should be, what kind of reforms might come in the future. And I think the point of my book is to not just introduce these questions and these topics, but to say that these are much more important for all of us here in Europe or whichever part of the world you're in, Africa too, much more important to be watching these actors and these investments, what's going right and what's going wrong, than any other thing that's going on in the world right now.
So I suppose the question is, what do you think that the old powers reactions are going to be to this changing world?
Well, I think in some cases there's a sudden awareness that the world is changing. Actually, I think if you read my book, that these changes have very deep roots. It's not the last year or two or last 5 years, it's the last 20 or 30 years we've seen these dramatic changes. In some cases, the United States finding it very hard to work out how to deal with not just China, but also with Russia and Iran and other states across Asia, where the growth of their economies, the ambitions of their military, in the South China Sea, for example, China's busy building artificial islands. The Americans' assessment is that there's a considerable risk that Moscow might use nuclear weapons as a first strike, and how should the United States military adapt to this? And I think that this changing world, which seems very unfamiliar to us, is one that we need to understand better. That's what the job of history and historians can be, to explain who's who, why are there tensions and rivalries, where are there opportunities, and what is the best way we can do to try to engage with other parts of the world. But what's very striking from the United States point of view is that, as we sit here at the end of 2018, there are sanctions on the leadership in Russia, there's sanctions on the leadership group and on the country of Iran, and there's a $250 billion of tariffs on the Chinese economy. And in the meantime, America's been busy cutting its ties with countries like Pakistan and, in fact, reducing aid even in Africa. So this world, which seems unfamiliar, you can see lots of different responses to. And here in Britain and in Europe is no different. There is a rising unpopularity with the European Union, the rise of the left and the rise of the right. And some of that is a reaction, I think, to the fact that the world is changing. And in some cases, understanding why that's the change, why the changes are taking place, is the way to best understand how to respond to them.
Just before we go, may I ask you what's next? I know this new Silk Road has just come out, but do you have anything in mind for the next book, perhaps?
Yes, I'm like an air traffic controller. I've got lots of little books in the air. At the moment, I'm very interested in. I've got a big book I'm writing about Russia and trying to explain Russia in a maybe a slightly different way. But at the moment, I'm working through a lot of materials from in Arabic and Chinese and Khmer and Greek from the Middle Ages, trying to see the role that environment has played in the rise of cities and in the changes of political cultures. So that, like a good miner, I disappear into the library, into archives, and that's the best bit, actually. I love the process of researching, because you have a chance to have ideas which sometimes they don't lead anywhere, but when they do, it's like finding your favourite sweets And then being sitting there eating them before you explain to everybody else what you've got hold of. So that's
new things as well. And it's really exciting.
I love it. And I think we human beings, and why I love bookshops, it speaks to our curiosity. You know, when you walk into a bookshop and you take a book off the shelf that you weren't expecting to buy about a subject you don't know anything about, and then you come home, you know, that's the best day out that I can think of.
To be honest, I'd like to ask you another 10 questions, but I'm afraid we've run out of time. Let me thank you for writing the most interesting eye-opening book I've read this year. And thank you very much for coming to the bookstore. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you here.
That's so kind, thank you.